Hi, I'm Petty Officer Christina Brockman. Join Staff Sergeant Jimmy Williams and me on Navy Marine Corps News. This week, Marine Raiders from World War II are laid to rest at Arlington National Cemetery. The top scout sniper teams in the Marine Corps compete in Quantico, Virginia.
We're just like anyone else, you know, we go out and we do our job and we do it the best we can.
And sailors and Marines in Hawaii go the extra mile to fight cancer. These stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, Marine Raiders from World War II are laid to rest at Arlington National Cemetery. The top scout sniper teams in the Marine Corps compete in Quantico, Virginia. And sailors and Marines in Hawaii go the extra mile to fight cancer. These stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News.
Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Petty Officer Christina Brockman.
And I'm Staff Sergeant Jimmy Williams.
We recently had the opportunity to talk to our new Secretary of the Navy, Gordon England. He highlighted his four points of emphasis, with the most important being people.
We have a superb force. I mean, the men and women in uniform are absolutely magnificent. They're well-trained, they're motivated, highly, highly capable, and very, very impressive. There's no question this is the finest military in the world.
Secretary England said one of the reasons our people are the best is because of their dedication to learning.
I am surprised at the level of education of our total force. The whole force is highly, highly educated.
And that force is important to him, which is why he feels we must continue the focus on safety.
Safety is very, very important. It's at the very top of my agenda. We don't let accidents happen. We don't let them happen to people we love and care for.
While people are his number one priority, Secretary England's other points of emphasis are combat capability, technology, and business practices.
Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Vern Clark has announced that the Navy has taken another step towards aligning the fleet. Fleet alignment was one of Admiral Clark's top five priorities when he took over as CNO. This vision will become reality October 1st. The fleet alignment is designed for three reasons: to unify the fleets, standardize fleet-wide practices, and make sure the Navy is as combat capable as possible.
This alignment will bring us to bed together in both the Atlantic and the Pacific fleets in ways that we've never known before, and I believe will make us much more effective and combat ready.
Previously, the Atlantic and Pacific fleets each developed their own concepts and policies. The alignment will integrate the two individual fleet plans, so practices will be standardized throughout the Navy.
The most important thing about aligning our fleet is to make sure that we deliver the right tools to our people so that we can accomplish the mission in the most efficient and the most effective way. I believe that for us to remain a forward deployed force, we have to have sufficient force structure to make sure that we can meet the rotations without placing undue stress on our people.
The CNO's plan to better align the fleet is complete for now, but he will continue to review the realignment and adjust it if necessary.
As the senior enlisted advisor to the Chief of Naval Operations, Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy Jim Herdt makes it his goal to stay up on what's important to sailors around the fleet. Master Chief Herdt went to the Arabian Gulf recently to visit with shipboard sailors and talk about their quality of life.
Our sailors are valued professionals that we need to provide a good balance between their quality of work and their quality of life so that they see us as the employer of choice.
According to MCPON Minute, the Navy has improved quite rapidly over the last 3.5 years with pay raises, a new college program, as well as improved living conditions.
Our sailors are warriors in every respect, but they have families that they want to take care of, and they deserve to live a very good quality of life in the country that they serve to protect.
The Navy also has plans to improve training methods.
Much of our A school's training will be brick and mortar, all the way out through computer-based training, distance learning, and even some virtual reality. So we think that there's better ways to train, and we're going to begin capitalizing on them.
During his trip to the Arabian Gulf, MCPON Herdt visited 9 ships in 3 days, as well as naval support activity Bahrain.
The Defense Department is still trying to locate more than 88,000 American service members who are still missing in action from World War II through the Vietnam War. Remains of some Marines were recently discovered, including the first enlisted Marine to receive the Medal of Honor during World War II. Petty Officer April Ash has more.
The 2nd Raider Battalion Marines who were left behind after making a toll raid were finally home. They had been missing in action since August 1942. Their remains were found in a mass grave in November 1999, then identified by the Army and brought back to the United States. The Marines were honored together.
Four of these units were deactivated on 1 February 1944. Marine Raiders would distinguish themselves in Guadalcanal, New Georgia, Bougainville, and other campaigns. Marine Raiders would earn 7 Medals of Honor, 125 Navy Crosses, 316 Silver Stars, and 2,406 Purple Hearts as testaments to their courage and their tenacity.
Their mission was to organize and conduct guerrilla commando attacks behind enemy lines and with operational units. Over 5,000 Marines wanted to be a part of this unit. They had to make it through some rigorous training to see if they were found suitable.
People in it seem hard and tough at times in various situations, but they're loyal to each other and to the Marine Corps, and that's worth remembering.
The 13 fallen Marines were laid to rest on August 17th, the same day they lost their lives on Vataratari Island. They were buried in Arlington, side by side, just as they were found. I'm Petty Officer April Ash, Navy Marine Corps News.
Attention all sailors and Marines with spouses and or children. As of November 1st, both will be covered under the Service Members Group Life Insurance Program.
Enrollment is automatic. The premium for coverage of spouses has not yet been set, but coverage for children is free.
If you have any questions, check out the Center for Career Development's website at staynavy.navy.mil.
Time for our first break. When we come back, snipers take out the competition at Quantico.
Hello, shipmates. MCPON Herdt here. If there's one thing that sailors want more of, it's educational opportunities. While the Navy offers a wide variety of off-duty educational options, there is one in particular that I want each of you to know about today. It's www.navylearning.com or .mil. This e-learning website provides training anytime, anywhere to active duty and reserve sailors and Marines, and even some family members. There are over 1,000 courses available, ranging from damage control and firefighting to computer application development. The site also offers a large number of leadership and management courses, which I highly encourage all Navy leaders to consider. This site has features that allow you to develop a learning plan and online chats that let you discuss your courses with instructors and other students. Until next week, I'll see you about the fleet.
Hi, I'm Gordon England, Secretary of the Navy, and you're watching Navy Marine Corps News.
Marine Lieutenant George Ives is an avid hiker. Today, he's up early exploring a remote forest. The only person that knows he's here, just one person, Lieutenant George Ives. Lieutenant Ives was lucky. He was eventually rescued by a forest ranger who spotted his abandoned vehicle. But this incident could easily have ended in tragedy. Never hike or climb alone. Don't take unnecessary risks. Stay on designated hiking paths. Finally, tell someone you trust where you are going and when you expect to be back.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News.
On August 10th, the Scout Sniper School in Quantico, Virginia announced the winner of the Marine Corps Scout Sniper Competition, and Sergeant Jimmy Perkins was there.
For 1 week, two-man teams from the four Marine Expeditionary Forces engaged in a 30-event competition. The mission of a Scout Sniper team is to provide reconnaissance, forward observation, and place precise rounds on target for unit commanders.
I have control. 5, 4, 3, 2.
The purpose for the Scout Sniper Championship was to identify the best Scout Sniper team in the Marine Corps. There were three major categories that were being tested. Mental and physical, meaning written tests and some physical activities. Within the field skills category, there were about 10 different field skills that they were tested in. For marksmanship, they were required to qualify with the M9, with the M16, and the M48-1 sniper rifle.
Just take it. Ready? Fire. Stop.
Did you get any sleep last night?
An hour or so. Not much. We spent a lot of the night moving.
The grueling competition featured 96 hours of continuous operations, which pushed these Scout Snipers to new levels of achievement.
I think the only way they overcame it was from their training, prior training. The training they did with their units helped them overcome a lot of it. And also the aspect of wanting to win the competition, that was kind of like the catch-all. And they all came here to win, so none of them wanted to give up.
The winning team, Corporal Tim Hogan and Corporal Mike Anglin, representing 3rd Battalion, 2nd Marines, attributed their success to teamwork.
Like Hogan always keeps me going, you know, because I'm tired and worn out or whatever, you know. He's like, come on, let's go.
All right, here it is, let's go. Come on, Mike.
And even though there was only one winner, each team took home with them the pride of a job well done and experiences to share and pass on to their fellow Marines. Sergeant Jimmy Perkins, Navy Marine Corps News.
Next week, we'll take a closer look at the Scout Sniper Championships and what it takes to be one of these highly specialized Marines.
As a result of terrorist threats at home and abroad, the Navy has been stepping up security measures throughout the fleet.
Petty Officer April Gornflow of our Norfolk Bureau tells us about a new initiative to protect sailors.
Submarines are the silent stalkers of the ocean depths. Underwater, they're one of the best weapons in the Navy's arsenal. But like most naval vessels, they're nearly defenseless when pulling in and out of port. A new security measure will assist these vessels during that transition period.
The purpose of the escort boat is to go ahead and provide a capability to defend Navy vessels, submarines, aircraft carriers, other vessels when they're restricted in their ability to maneuver in shallow waters, such as the channel.
The escort boat has machine guns mounted on the front and back. It's fully prepared to defend against a terrorist attack. A group of sailors from Submarine Support Squadron Unit volunteered to run the escort boat service. They say their work is appreciated.
You just never know what's going to happen. You know, from prior experiences, what's happened in the past, and you just never know. And this is an awesome service for them, and they do appreciate it.
Prior to implementing the escort boat program, sailors went through an extensive training regimen.
We went to M60 training, and then we went on the boat training. And, you know, we did the live exercises and the range and the whole nine yards to get qualified in it.
Senior enlisted sailors and officers are serving as coxswains on the escort boats. They've been trained in the use of force, up to and including the use of deadly force.
Hopefully, the services of the escort boat will always be just a precaution, but sailors can now feel more secure when they're headed out to sea. Reporting from Norfolk, Petty Officer April Gormflow, Navy Marine Corps News.
The ability to receive and send information is the key to force command and control. When commanders are away from base, communications take on a new importance.
Sailors in Bahrain are using two high-tech mobile communication suites to keep commanders informed when conducting exercises. One is the MAST, which stands for Mobile Ashore Support Terminal. The other is the MICFAC, or Mobile Integrated Command Facility.
The MAST is very small, but it's quickly deployable. It comes in a few boxes. You can take them, put them on an airplane within a couple of hours, and go provide some comms. The downside is the comms aren't very robust. There's not a whole lot that you get with that package. The MICFAC takes a while to deploy. We have to pack these vans up. It takes us a little while to do it, and it takes C-141, a couple of them, or a C-17 or a C-5 to get us in place.
The two systems provide commanders with secure internet, satellite phone links, video teleconferencing, and message traffic.
Seabees build and fight all over the world, from the Pacific Islands to the jungles of Vietnam, from the sands of Saudi Arabia to the mountains of Bosnia.
Petty Officer Denny Lester recently caught up with Seabees off the coast of Africa, where they assisted the Cape Verde military in building a schoolhouse for underprivileged children.
Seabees of Naval Mobile Construction Battalion 40 are completing a humanitarian project in Cape Verde, Africa. The 34 Seabees are constructing a two-story, 5,000-square-foot shelter and education facility for orphans and abused children. Cape Verde has underdeveloped living conditions, and crew leader BU-2 James Dolan says most of the crew has never been exposed to such widespread poverty.
Well, at first, I know eyes opened wide, and everyone's pretty much accepted it and kind of helped out where they can. Some of the Cape Verdeans, they aren't as fortunate as we are with what we have. So I definitely see a lot of the crew seeing and being grateful for what they have back in the States.
The project was also the first time the Seabees have worked with the Cape Verde military. While working together, the Seabees train the Cape Verdeans in the construction skills they will need to do similar projects in the future.
The people that we have met have been fantastic. It's a very poor country, and the things that they have to offer to everybody are their friendship, their music, and the wonderful food. It's been an absolutely fantastic experience, and definitely the pinnacle of my career so far.
With ribbon cutting scheduled for August 20th, these Seabees are leaving a very positive landmark in their wake. Reporting from Cape Verde, Africa, I'm Navy journalist Denny Lester.
Service members can choose to contribute a percentage of their pay to the military's Thrift Savings and Investment Program beginning October 9th.
You can enroll in the savings plan from October 9th until January 31st. After that, there will be two periods each year when you can join, quit, or change the amount of your contributions.
You can download an enrollment form from the Thrift Savings Plan website. The address is tsp.gov.
For more information, check out the website or contact your finance office.
When we come back, we'll meet a Marine, a single father of two, and a rap artist.
I'm Vin Diesel. You're watching Navy Marine Corps News. And if it wasn't you guys, I wouldn't be doing this. But I support what you do.
Says you have to drink. Get the right spirit. Target Fitness.
Sometimes it's hard to be noticed in the crowd. One out of five heart attacks are caused by smoking. One out of five deaths in the U.S. are caused by smoking. One out of four smokers will die before they reach retirement age. 9 out of 10 lung cancer cases are caused by smoking. Average survival rates are less than 5 years. Don't smoke. Stand out from the crowd.
Welcome back.
Last week, we gave you an update on the repairs being made to USS Cole. While at the shipyard, we spoke to two sailors who were on the ship that tragic day and are now watching the renovations take place. Both expressed excitement at the prospect of getting the determined warrior back underway.
I wanted to see the ship sail again. And I wanted to be on it when it did.
By us fixing the Cole and getting it back in the water, it's going to show the rest of the world what we already know, which is that we are the finest Navy in the world.
I've gotten underway a lot in my career, but there'll be a lot of emotion involved for a lot of people when that ship sails again.
The name pretty much says it all. We are the determined warrior. We got to fight through this. We got to prove to ourselves, the United States, and the world that, you know, you got us, but you didn't. You're not going to keep us down, because we are the determined warrior, and we're coming back stronger than ever.
The Cole is set to go back in the water September 15th and back underway next year.
Poor eating habits can lead to a variety of health problems.
And for service members, being overweight can affect our job performance and our career.
In our next story, Petty Officer Jennifer Smith tells us how to eat healthier.
Controlling your weight is not only important to your military career, but it is even more important to your health. Being overweight is an important risk factor for people with cardiovascular disease. And it also contributes to the onset of adult diabetes. Up until a few weeks ago, it was thought that genetics caused this form of diabetes.
The Department of Health and Human Services released a study they did where the increase of weight and your risk for diabetes. Just a little exercise every day and keeping an eye on your weight can prevent the onset of diabetes.
While the Navy makes it easy to get enough exercise, it's just as important to watch what you eat when you're trying to control your weight. One common misconception is only looking at how much fat, carbohydrates, or protein you eat. But to lose weight effectively, it's simply about counting calories.
If it's a calorie-free, I mean, that's great, but something that says fat-free, sodium-free, sugar-free does not mean calorie-free. The bottom line is, if you eat it and you don't work it off, you keep it.
So what are some simple ways of cutting calories? One way is to order a hamburger instead of a cheeseburger. A slice of American cheese contains about 70 calories. If you eat hamburgers 5 times a week, that's 350 calories you can cut out that week alone.
If you, on the ship, you do have access to a salad bar, put the dressing in a side cup. Dip your fork in the cup and then stab your salad. You may save 100 to 200 calories per salad.
But it's important to know that food is not the enemy. Starving yourself or even just skipping a meal is just as dangerous.
The thinking that, oh, I won't eat or I'll save my calories for later, you actually don't burn calories at a normal rate. So we want you to eat. It's just how much.
So how much is enough? Well, that depends on your age, height, weight, activity level, and whether you're trying to lose or gain weight.
Next time you stop by the ghee dunk machine in your office or on your ship, why not try some pretzels? If you stick with these simple tips, you'll be sure to keep the extra weight off. I'm Petty Officer Jennifer Smith, Navy Marine Corps News.
Sailors and Marines in Hawaii recently helped raise money for the American Cancer Society. Seaman John Watts from our Pearl Harbor Bureau went along and files this report.
Typically, this Army base is closed to the public, but today it hosts an opportunity for Oahu residents to help the community and get some exercise. One sailor's motivation was more personal.
I'm doing it for the Cancer Society because my dad was a victim of cancer and he just passed away last year.
The event featured a 13-mile run.
I've been training running barefoot for the last 2.5 years, so I'm basically running.
I ran it barefoot.
And a 6-mile walk.
I came out here because me and my wife are trying to get more active.
As runners and walkers crossed the finish line and the awards were handed out, it was obvious that all participants were winners.
I'm trying to get more active in the community, and I always like to do
do something for a good cause like the American Cancer Society.
Reporting from the Kolekole Pass, Hawaii, I'm Seaman John Watts.
How far?
1 mile.
Navy Marine Corps News.
In our next story, we'll meet Sergeant Victor Sims, an active reservist who wears many hats. Petty Officer Kara Hunt tells us more.
Sergeant Victor Sims works at Marine Forces Reserve in New Orleans as the Adjutant Chief for Headquarters Battalion. After 4 years on active duty, he joined the active reserve force so he could better care for his two young girls, ages 3 and 4.
The AR program is the only program that I can go into that's basically family-oriented, the way I can go to a certain place. I won't be deployed, won't have to worry about going overseas, and I can basically concentrate on raising my daughters and still being in the Marine Corps, you know.
Being active reserve has also allowed him to devote attention to his music career.
Yeah, man. I basically had given up on music for a while. I was going to stay in the military. And one day, they gave me a phone call. And they invited me to come here to the studio, and it started like that. And the next day, I came in, recorded. That Saturday, shot a video. Actually, that Sunday, we shot a video for the first single, and I knew it was real.
Sims Group is in talks with a major label and hopes to sign with them soon. For Sims, the sky is the limit.
No one gets in this profession, you know, not wanting to be successful.
Feeling the burdens of a single parent with my little daughter's growth.
You're sacrificing a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of energy, a lot of everything. I give the Marine Corps what I can give them, you know. If they need me to do it, like I tell them, I'll do it. A time hasn't come to where they both clash. I love to do this. I love to do the music. You know, I love my children, so there's nothing I wouldn't do for them. My kids are my pride and joy.
Petty Officer Kara Hunt, Navy Marine Corps News.
Well, that's the show for this week. As always, we'd like to hear your thoughts and ideas about Navy Marine Corps News. So call our feedback line or send us an email.
The number and address are coming up in a minute. But before we go, we'd like to say BZ to the Navy Dental Corps.
On August 22nd, over 5,500 Dental Corps surgeons and technicians celebrated 89 years of providing care to our Navy Marine Corps team. Thanks.
We'd also like to say hello and thanks for watching to Sailors and Marines in the USS Enterprise Carrier Battle Group.
They are currently patrolling the Arabian Gulf and enforcing the southern no-fly zone in Iraq.
We leave you this week with another look at the Marine Sniper Competition at Quantico, Virginia.
Until next week.
Take care.
Number one, you got to train like your number two.
Sergeant Victor Sims works at Marine Forces Reserve in New Orleans as the Adjutant Chief for Headquarters Battalion. After 4 years on active duty, he joined the active reserve force so he could better care for his two young girls, ages 3 and 4.
The AR program is the only program that I can go into that's basically family-oriented, the way I can go to a certain place. I won't be deployed, won't have to worry about going overseas, and I can basically concentrate on raising my daughters and still being in the Marine Corps, you know.
Being active reserve has also allowed him to devote attention to his music career.
Yeah, man. I basically had given up on music for a while. I was gonna stay in the military. And one day they gave me a phone call. And they invited me to come here to the studio, and it started like that. And the next day I came in, recorded. That Saturday, shot a video. Actually, that Sunday, we shot a video for the first single, and I knew it was real.
Sims Group is in talks with a major label and hopes to sign with them soon. For Sims, the sky is the limit.
No one gets in this profession, you know, not wanting to be successful. Feeling the burdens of a single parent with my little daughter's growth. You're sacrificing a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of energy, a lot of everything. I give the Marine Corps what I can give them, you know. If they need me to do it, like I tell them, I'll do it. A time hasn't come to where they both clash. I love to do this. I love to do the music. You know, I love my children, so there's nothing I wouldn't do for them. My kids are my pride and joy.
Petty Officer Kara Hunt, Navy Marine Corps News.
Typically, this Army base is closed to the public, but today it hosts an opportunity for Oahu residents to help the community and get some exercise. One sailor's motivation was more personal.
I'm doing it for the Cancer Society because my dad was a victim of cancer and he just passed away last year.
The event featured a 13-mile run.
I've been training running barefoot for the last 2.5 years, so I'm basically running.
I ran it barefoot. And a 6-mile walk.
I came out here because me and my wife are trying to get more active.
As runners and walkers crossed the finish line and the awards were handed out, it was obvious that all participants were winners.
I'm trying to get more active in the community, and I always like to do something for a good cause like the American Cancer Society.
Reporting from the Kolikoli Pass, Hawaii, I'm Seaman John Watts.
How far?
Navy Marine Corps News.
Master Chief Herdt went to the Arabian Gulf recently to visit with shipboard sailors and talk about their quality of life.
Our sailors are valued professionals that we need to provide a good balance between their quality of work and their quality of life so that they see us as the employer of choice.
According to MCPON Herdt, the Navy has improved quite rapidly over the last 3.5 years with pay raises, a new college program, as well as improved living conditions.
Our sailors are warriors in every respect, but they have families that they want to take care of, and they deserve to live a very good quality of life in the country that they serve to protect.
The Navy also has plans to improve training methods.
Much of our A school's training will be brick and mortar, all the way out through computer-based training, distance learning, and even some virtual reality. So we think that there's better ways to train, and we're going to begin capitalizing on them.
Controlling your weight is not only important to your military career, but it is even more important to your health. Being overweight is an important risk factor for people with cardiovascular disease, and it also contributes to the onset of adult diabetes. Up until a few weeks ago, it was thought that genetics caused this form of diabetes.
The Department of Health and Human Services released a study they did where the increase of weight and your risk for diabetes. Just a little exercise every day and keeping an eye on your weight can prevent the onset of diabetes.
While the Navy makes it easy to get enough exercise, it's just as important to watch what you eat when you're trying to control your weight. One common misconception is only looking at how much fat, carbohydrates, or protein you eat. But to lose weight effectively, it's simply about counting calories.
If it's a calorie-free, I mean, that's great, but something that says fat-free, sodium-free, sugar-free, does not mean calorie free. The bottom line is, if you eat it and you don't work it off, you keep it.
So what are some simple ways of cutting calories? One way is to order a hamburger instead of a cheeseburger. A slice of American cheese contains about 70 calories. If you eat hamburgers 5 times a week, that's 350 calories you can cut out that week alone.
If you, on the ship, you do have access to a salad bar, put the dressing in a side cup. Dip your fork in the cup and then stab your salad. You may save 100 to 200 calories per salad.
But it's important to know that food is not the enemy. Starving yourself or even just skipping a meal is just as dangerous.
The thinking that, oh, I won't eat or I'll save my calories for later, you actually don't burn calories at a normal rate. So we want you to eat. It's just how much.
So how much is enough? Well, that depends on your age, height, weight, activity level, and whether you're trying to lose or gain weight.
Next time you stop by the G-Dunk machine in your office or on your ship, why not try some pretzels? If you stick with these simple tips, you'll be sure to keep the extra weight off. I'm Petty Officer Jennifer Smith, Navy Marine Corps News.
The fleet alignment is designed for three reasons: to unify the fleets, standardize fleet-wide practices, and make sure the Navy is as combat capable as possible.
This alignment will bring us to bet together in both the Atlantic and the Pacific fleets in ways that we've never known before, and I believe will make us much more effective and combat ready.
Previously, the Atlantic and Pacific fleets each developed their own concepts and policies. The alignment will integrate the two individual fleet plans, so practices will be standardized throughout the Navy.
The most important thing about aligning our fleet is to make sure that we deliver the right tools to our people so that we can accomplish the mission in the most efficient and the most effective way. I believe that for us to remain a forward deployed force, we have to have sufficient force structure to make sure that we can meet the rotations without placing undue stress on our people.
The CNO's plan to better align the fleet is complete for now, but he will continue to review the realignment and adjust it if necessary.
I wanted to see the ship sail again, and I wanted to be on it when it did.
By us fixing the coal and getting it back in the water, it's going to show the rest of the world what we already know, which is that we are the finest Navy in the world.
I've gotten underway a lot in my career, but there'll be a lot of emotion involved for a lot of people when that ship sails again.
The name pretty much says it all. We are the determined warrior. We got to fight through this. We got to prove to ourselves, the United States, and the world that, you know, you got us, but you didn't, you're not gonna keep us down, because we are the determined warrior, and we're coming back stronger than ever.
Submarines are the silent stalkers of the ocean depths. Underwater, they're one of the best weapons in the Navy's arsenal. But like most naval vessels, they're nearly defenseless when pulling in and out of port. A new security measure will assist these vessels during that transition period.
The purpose of the escort boat is to go ahead and provide a capability to defend Navy vessels, submarines, aircraft carriers, other vessels when they're restricted in their ability to maneuver in shallow waters, such as the channel.
The escort boat has machine guns mounted on the front and back. It's fully prepared to defend against a terrorist attack.
The escort craft has M60 machine guns fore and aft, with approximately 180 degrees of arc, so they can cover 360. And it's a vice a V-hull, it's a catamaran, so it gives you a much more stable platform in higher sea states for firing.
A group of sailors from Submarine Support Squadron Unit volunteered to run the escort boat service. They say their work is appreciated.
You just never know what's going to happen. You know, from prior experiences, what's happened in the past, and you just never know. And this, I think this is an awesome service for them, and they do appreciate it.
Prior to implementing the escort boat program, sailors went through an extensive training regimen.
We went to M60 training, and then we went on the boat training. And, you know, we did the live exercises and the range and the whole nine yards to get qualified in it.
Senior enlisted sailors and officers are serving as coxswains on the escort boats. They've been trained in the use of force, up to and including the use of deadly force.
Hopefully, the services of the escort boat will always be just a precaution. But sailors can now feel more secure when they're headed out to sea. Reporting from Norfolk, Petty Officer April Gormflow, Navy Marine Corps News.
The 2nd Raider Battalion Marines, who were left behind after making a toll raid, were finally home. They had been missing in action since August 1942. Their remains were found in a mass grave in November 1999, then identified by the Army and brought back to the United States. The Marines were honored together.
Four of these units were deactivated on 1 February 1944. Marine Raiders would distinguish themselves in Guadalcanal, New Georgia, Bougainville, and other campaigns. Marine Raiders would earn 7 medals of honor, 125 Navy crosses, 316 Silver Stars, and 2,406 Purple Hearts as testaments to their courage and their tenacity.
Their mission was to organize and conduct guerrilla commando attacks behind enemy lines and with operational units. Over 5,000 Marines wanted to be a part of this unit. They had to make it through some rigorous training to see if they were found suitable.
People in it seemed hard and tough at times in various situations, but they're loyal to each other and to the Marine Corps, and that's worth remembering.
The 13 fallen Marines were laid to rest on August 17th, the same day they lost their lives on Vataratari Island. They were buried in Arlington, side by side, just as they were found. I'm Petty Officer April Ash, Navy Marine Corps News.
Seabees of Naval Mobile Construction Battalion 40 are completing a humanitarian project in Cape Verde, Africa. The 34 Seabees are constructing a two-story, 5,000-square-foot shelter and education facility for orphans and abused children. Cape Verde has underdeveloped living conditions, and crew leader BU-2 James Dolan says most of the crew has never been exposed to such widespread poverty.
Well, at first, I know eyes opened wide, and everyone's pretty much accepted it, and kind of helped out where they can. Some of the Cape Verdeans, they aren't as fortunate as we are with what we have. I definitely see a lot of the crew seeing and being grateful for what they have back in the States.
The project was also the first time the Seabees have worked with the Cape Verde military. While working together, the Seabees train the Cape Verdeans in the construction skills they will need to do similar projects in the future.
The people that we have met have been fantastic. It's a very poor country, and the things that they have to offer to everybody, their friendship, their music, and the wonderful food. It's been an absolutely fantastic experience and definitely the pinnacle of my career so far.
With ribbon cutting scheduled for August 20th, these Seabees are leaving a very positive landmark in their wake. Reporting from Cape Verde, Africa, I'm Navy journalist Denny Lester.